There we go. So today we've got a bit of a double session. So starting us off, we have our very own Mark Corea, who's going to talk us through the state of the social care sector in England. This builds off the report, which we launched a couple of months ago, searching for consensus, which followed a survey last year of social care organisations across the country, along with some proposals that we think are in urgent need of being introduced. And after the questions and answers with Mark, we're going to move over to Sister Ellen, who's going to provide a little summary of what we've heard this week, because it's been quite a wide-ranging week in the subjects we've covered, it deliberately so, to mirror the subjects that we put forward in the Vincentian Manifesto ahead of the general election. So a chance on this feast day just to reflect on how those values have been lived out and then where we all go from here. But it's lovely to see you all. You're all very welcome. And Mark, over to you.
Morning, everyone. Yeah, just load my presentation up. Can everyone see that? Cool, perfect. Yeah, so a very happy feast to everyone. I'd like to say thanks for joining this morning, but also for joining this week. And we've had some really good speakers. I'll try to live up to them, but it's going to be very difficult. So today I'm going to be talking about our social care work, in particular, reflecting on our report that we did launched in June and just talking a bit about recent government developments and what we might see in the future. And just to note that when I talk about social care, it's referring to adult social care, which primarily covers the care for the elderly and the disabled, which can either be in care homes or domiciliary care in people's own homes, but it also covers other types of care. But those are the primary types of care. And I think just to reflect briefly on the Vincentian values, it's very easy to see how social care fits within our values. I think for me, the second, third, and fifth values there are the most relevant to social care. You can see how people who are in care deserve to be treated with dignity, and people working care are often the most compassionate and kindest people that you know. And through this report, we're trying to act in solidarity for justice. So I think it's very clear to see how social care fits within our value framework. And we're very lucky within our group to have three social care projects. You only have to visit them for a second to see how these values play out in the lives of the staff and the people living there. So yeah, just to show those who haven't seen, this is our report, Searching for Consensus. We launched this in June, although the research started before I joined the Daughters of Charity Services, when our Rihanna and my predecessor Dakota launched a survey of social care organizations to try and understand the issues that they're facing and try and find some recommendations that we could put forward to the government to solve some of the crisis that we're facing. It covers three main sections, which are recruitment, retention, and funding of the social care sector. And the report analyzes the data we found in our survey. And we managed to have over 200 people responding to the survey, which is a really good body of data. We had a very good response to this in the press. So we had features in Universe Catholic Weekly, the Independent Catholic News, Care Management Matters magazine, and also shout outs in the Catholic Union newsletter and the Tablet newsletter, which were very positive. So the first section that we touched on was recruitment. It's been quite widely reported in the news that there's staffing issues with many sectors across the country, but social care is probably feeling this most acutely. So you can see in that graph that there are a large majority of respondents said it was very difficult or difficult to recruit social care workers since January 2022. And you can see there the stat that 152,000 vacant posts a day in 2022, 2023, and the vacancy rate was 9.9%. This is much higher than the wider economy. So you can see how social care is facing this most significantly. And the reasons that were cited and from people who responded to our survey were that low pay, lack of experience and qualifications, and the lasting impact of COVID-19 on the profession were driving this recruitment issue. It's a stark stat there that we see that 444,000, sorry, 400, yeah, 440,000 more care workers will be needed to meet demand projected by 2035, which is just about 10 years away, and without massively driving for more recruitment. It's unclear how we're going to meet that number. The second issue that we had touched on was retention of care staff. So although massive issues with recruiting care staff, there are also issues with retaining care staff. And it's estimated that the turnover rate for social care staff was 28.3% in 2022 to 23. This is a massive number. So essentially, within the 1 year of joining, there was a 28.3% chance that a social care worker would leave the profession. And this creates massive issues for management. It creates more costs, having to hire more, advertise more posts, spend more time interviewing. And it's something government really needs to take seriously if we're going to meet the issue of lack of staff in the social care sector. I think the issues cited kind of just show how we need to really take this seriously in government, but also as care organisations, got to take some solutions forward to the government, which is what we tried to do through our report. And the main reason that the main recommendation we had from this was to improve the retention by increasing the training progression available to care staff. The issue is that once care staff are in post, they often find it hard to get advancement and career progression, partially because in order to get that, you'd have to take time out of the day to do training. And when there's not enough staff already, it's very hard to give people a day off to do some more training in order to get to higher pay bands or higher posts in their organizations. And the government has taken some action on this. So they launched the care certificate level 2, although this was frequently cited within the trade press as not being enough. Although it does allow care staff to have another qualification on their CV, again, it doesn't solve the issue of not having enough time to take off work to do the certificate. And it's also unclear how once many people in the care sector do the certificate, it's not going to differentiate one from another in terms of hiring for a higher role. So, yes, it's very, very clear that we need to do more on this. And the funding was the third section. And many of you may have been aware that the Boris Johnson government had a massive announcement back in 2019 on funding for care sector, and also in 2022, the autumn statement, there was £7.5 billion pledged to the care sector, but it's really unclear to see where any of this money has gone. Lots of it has been delayed until October 2025, and now actually the Labour government has actually reversed some of that funding as well. So of the 7.5 billion, I think it's estimated that only about 2 billion of this was delivered, and that's a massive funding gap for the sector. And you can see that even with that promised funding, the majority of organizations said it's not clear how that would even help. So 40% of organizations said they strongly disagree or disagree that this funding would help. Because although you can increase the funding for the sector and try and increase staff progression and pay rates, ultimately, there's massive issues within the sector that funding, just throwing more money, isn't going to solve. And so we need to take that into account when considering further reform. And one interesting stat is from the Health Foundation that 8.3 billion more pounds of funding would be needed by 2032 just to meet demand, but 18.4 billion would be needed to improve access to care and cover the cost of care. Although government might be able to pledge more money, that the number 18.4 billion, the deficit for next year is 20 billion. So it's very clear that this is not going to be delivered. And it's very, very concerning, considering the rumors that we've heard about cuts to various services and benefits of the next autumn statement in October. So that covers the kind of findings on our report. And I'd also like to talk about the next steps. So we launched a report on the 24th of June, and we were paying very close attention to the general election. And I will talk a bit about the government's manifesto promises. And so the government had appointed its care minister, Stephen Kinnock, the son of previous leader Neil Kinnock. And the manifesto acknowledged the problem, stating that the sector needs deep reform. There are inconsistent standards, chronic staff shortages, and people are not always treated with the care, dignity, and respect they deserve. And I think on the surface, this sounds quite Vincentian in a way. And the hallmark policy of the Labour manifesto was to create the National Care Service. So as you'll see there, this is an excerpt from the manifesto. It would be underpinned by national standards, delivering consistency of care across the country, services would be locally delivered with a principle of home first that supports people to live independently for as long as possible. And I think this is probably going to play into their reforms massively over the next few years. Ultimately, they want to keep people in their homes for as long as possible, because that's the easiest way for people to live their lives. And once they enter the care sector, is very difficult for them to leave if they wanted to. So the government wants to support people to live happier and healthier lives for longer in their own homes, and before they then go on to enter the social care services. It's quite unclear at this stage how radical a national care service would be. I think it's very clear that's not going to be as radical as the NHS was when that was launched. But I think they want to take a massive stand, and the Secretary of State for Health and Social Care, Wes Streeting, did say at the Labour conference that if he did not solve the social care crisis before he leaves office, then he would deem his term in office as a failure. So I think that shows that there is a real appetite within government to do something about the sector, although it's very, very unclear at the moment what we are going to see. But that said, the Prime Minister did announce a few weeks ago that there would be a 10-year plan for the health and social care sector launching in the spring. And I think this will coincide with the March budget, which will be very interesting. At the moment, as I said earlier, they did cut some of the planned policies that Conservative government did implement. So, for example, there was a plan to cap social care costs for people at £86,000 over their lifetime, so that no person would pay more than £86,000, which is about on average 3 years of care. And after that, the government would fund that care through the local council. And this was abandoned recently in June, and the Chancellor said this would save £1 billion over the next financial year, again, to make up one out of 20 billion of the deficit that we're facing for next year. So I think really until next spring, it's going to be quite quiet in terms of what the government's doing. I know they're launching consultations, which we'll be engaging with, and obviously we'll try and reflect the views of our social care projects in that. Yeah, and finally, just to say thanks for listening to this. I know many of the daughters have heard this presentation before, but I just really wanted to talk about our report and some of the findings, and hopefully we'll see a bit more announcement at the next in next spring. And I'll post a link to the report in the chat for anyone who'd like to have a further read. Thanks very much.
Mark, thank you for talking us through that. We know how much work has gone into the report. And we were slightly frustrated when we were all set for launch, and then the election came along and derailed plans slightly. But like Mark says, the report is out there now, and we think some of the findings are, they're fairly alarming around the need for extraordinary investment in the sector. But also, I think from what we've seen so far is a perhaps worrying pattern of continuing the trend of prioritising, understandably, but prioritising NHS as the biggest crisis, with social care being not given the headline attention it deserves and requires. So I'm keen to open up to the group for questions. But again, while you're perhaps thinking of questions, I'd just like to say, Mark, so we've got a new government in power now. There's the pledge there. What are the best things we can keep doing to try and keep this on the agenda?
Yeah, I think so when the consultations launch in the autumn on government's 10-year health and social care plan, I think really engaging that will be key. Government does listen to stakeholders in these consultations, and I know from my previous roles that if you're able to have kind of a good body of data behind your submission, they will try and engage with you and respond to you. So I would say for us as a group, we'll try and reflect the views of St. Joseph's and the Marillac and Vincentian Care Plus, but also care organisations across the UK, from small care organisations to one of the massive ones. Just engage with that consultation. It's the best way to have your voice heard. And I also think just banging the drum of what we've said in the report and sending it to as many of the new MPs as possible and also the new ministers. I think, yeah, the government does want to listen. It's just often that they're competing with, you're competing with thousands of people and organisations in the same sector. But they do want to listen. And I think Wes Streeting has really come out and said He wants to try and solve the crisis. Ultimately, as Vincentians, we know that it's the person that's the most important in anything. And at the end of the day, people who are suffering are the people who need the care. The elderly and disabled deserve the care that they need.
Thanks, Mark. We've got a question from Nathan.
Yes, hi there. And just to say hello and introduce myself, I'm from the National Care Forum, so Trade Association for Not-for-Profit Providers. I know there's probably various links through different organisations you work with all of you. I just kind of just wanted to add to kind of some of the stuff Mark had said. So I've had the pleasure of being at both the Lib Dem and Labour Party conferences, with the Conservative ones to come this weekend. And I'd say the Labour Party conference, what was interesting was I got a sense of a change in tone. So yes, the NHS is always the thing that's at the top of the list, I think in a large part because it's the thing that cuts through to ordinary people. People understand what it is. It has that brand awareness. And the tone shift I heard was sort of Wes Streeting and Stephen Kinnock being more willing to talk about and describe themselves as social care ministers, talk about the need for long-term social care reform as well as short-term stabilisation. Now, at the moment, that's just words and we need to see some action behind that. But I just have a sense that the penny is beginning to drop a little bit, that, you know, social care in its own right is an important service. And that's something that I heard Wes Streeting say and acknowledge, which is interesting, rather than just something that benefits the NHS, which it does. So I think I'm kind of cautiously optimistic. And I think if everybody who's involved in social care in all the different ways, those providing professional care, unpaid carers, providers of care are sort of putting the pressure on, but sort of extending the hand of, we will work with you to get this right. I think that's the way forward. It's what we're certainly trying to do.
Thank you, Nathan. That is really positive to hear, actually. If they describe themselves as ministers and Secretary of State for social care as well as health, it's a big step forward in the recognition of the importance of this and how many people it affects. So that's, yeah, without getting too carried away, it's nice to hear there may be at least one step in the right direction. Yeah. And we'll keep working with the National Care Forum and others to keep pushing for this, but it has to be on the agenda. And just to add something to this as well, so the research itself was drawn from English care providers. We're very mindful of looking into the new year because care is a devolved issue. Not necessarily to replicate a similar research piece in Scotland, but we recognise, especially with an election coming up in the following year, that it will be a good time to start collating evidence, especially around the commissioning of care in Scotland and how much of an emphasis is given on prioritising the payment of organisations delivering care, because the recruitment and retention challenges are no different north of the border. So we're keen looking into the new year to see how we can work with Scottish care providers, both within our group and further afield as well, to try and get this on the agenda ahead of the Holyrood elections in 2026. So we're keen to keep pushing ahead with that.
Thanks, Mark. I'd like to also add, just as an aside, obviously all the policies we talk about, they mostly refer to care organisations that have contracts with local authorities. And there are, of course, you know, hundreds of thousands of people that care, unpaid carers for their children, their parents, their cousins, their wives, their husbands, their friends and family. And so, very, very hopefully we're going to see some action there. A lot of people either have to take time out of work or just give up work in order to care for their parents. And I'm sure we all have personal experience with something like that. And so I'm hoping that also we're going to hear some announcements on support for unpaid carers going forward as well.
Again, like you say, it's such a huge, huge issue, and there's so many people affected by it. I don't know if people have seen in the chat there as well, Nathan was just adding the priority the Liberal Democrats have given to social care as an issue, which I think we saw in the general election campaign. They seem to be the primary party in making this a core issue. And I think Ed Davies' personal experience spoke to an awful lot of people as well, on a very human level, kind of beyond a policy level, on a personal experience. And I think that is hopefully going to, again, if that can keep the issue in the public eye and we keep pushing ahead. Do we have any more questions for Mark? Sister Marie?
Yes, morning, Mark, and thank you. I'd like to ask you if your research covered different areas of the country given that it's local authorities that support social care? And did you find any differences between, say, London and the South and the North?
Thank you, Sister Marie. Yes, so our response was sent out to organisations across England, so from every coast, from every corner. And so I can share further details about this after as well, about the kind of geographic spread. And I think the main difference we found was that areas, more rural areas, seem to have more issues. I think it's the case in every sector where people are leaving kind of small towns in the country and heading to the cities, and that's the same for the social care sector. It's often very expensive to hire people in rural areas because they have to then have cars in order to drive from home to home. So the costs did seem to be higher for areas in more rural. But whereas in London, the home counties, they did have the same issues, but not quite as pronounced. So I think, yeah, we need to see more support for areas where there's obviously not as large transport links. And I think, yeah, going forward, I hope to see that.
Thanks, Mark.
Any more questions from the group before we move on? I just want to thank Mark, because like you said, he kind of came in with a lot of this research having already been done, but really pulling it together and delving into an awful lot of raw data to produce what's been, I think, a very, very helpful report to clarify just how urgent the situation. And the report was born out of, we'd had so many conversations, especially from hearing from members within our group of charities, where we'd leave and say, the state of the care sector is awful, isn't it? Someone should do something about it. So it's been a good starting point for us to say, right, let's pull the data together, take a proper survey of the sector and see where we go moving forwards. And the partnerships that we've been making with NCF and some of the others across the sector has been very helpful. So it's an issue that we will continue to push ahead on very strongly. Again, as Mark said right at the start, it reflects so deeply the Vincentian charism and the ethos of dignified service to those in need. So it's an issue we're not willing to drop anytime soon. Mark, thank you so much for this morning, for all the work you've done in pulling this together, but also for this presentation. It's a really great way of giving just a little snapshot of the report findings. And like I said, if you're happy to pop the link to the report in the chat, if anyone hasn't yet seen it, we'll make sure it's clearly available online as well. It's not a cheery read, but it's an important read. And I'd strongly recommend, if you've not seen it yet, going through. So thank you. Now we draw towards the end of the week. Sister Ellen, over to you.
Thank you. I just need you to make me a co-host, please, Mark. Thank you, Mark. Korea, I'm not sure how you managed to precede that as much as you did, but I suspect that you were trying to, you know, knowing there was a double whammy. But please do, there's so much information in that report, so I would encourage people to read further. Thanks for being so quick with it, but it was amazing just how you managed to tell us so much in such a short time. Am I on, Mark?
You are.
So I'm going to start my reflection by first of all wishing you all a very happy feast day. Nathan, welcome to the family. Thank you really to the DC Services team for putting together this week, which has been so diverse and kind of amazing, really, and lovely to see other partners coming online with us. Today, it's my privilege as the chair of DC Services to conclude and summarise the week and try to draw some reflections from it for us all to take away and work with. And it's amazing how even with the spread and the diversity, there are some kind of common things that come forward. But I've chosen a piece that I want to play to you. It's quite short, and there's another one for the end, because I want to kind of try to use it to put some of my thoughts together. So if you just bear with me, I'm going to share the screen. I haven't done this for ages, so bear with me. Now, Is that coming up for you? I can't see you, so you'll have to say something, Mark.
Yeah, we can see that.
Okay.
What is it that we have to do to change this world? What can I do? What can you do?
Sitting at home, all alone, just watching my TV. The news comes on, the world's gone wrong, that's how it seems to me. See people dying, people crying, got no food to eat. It ain't my life, so tell me why it means so much to me. Let's try to open our hearts. It's not too late to make a brand new start. Here and now, I believe there are solutions to the problems we see. We should all take a chance. Don't be afraid to lend a helping hand. This world could be so beautiful if we just work together to make a difference today. La 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 la. Open up your eyes, don't you realize they need you? Let's not run away, listen when I say that. Difference today.
So that puts us, I think, in the mood for reflection. A lot of those pictures were actually from the Philippines, because that's what the singer was singing about. But I chose it really for the text, because several things have kind of occurred to me during the week. We've seen a huge diverse range of problems. I've picked out a couple of texts from the song. So one of the things in the song is the problems we see all have solutions. And the second thing is that the world could be a beautiful place if we work together. And I want to kind of hook my reflection on those two thoughts, starting with the problems we see all have solutions. And the first thing I would say is that there is a kind of common trend in society to make the people the problem. And that, I think, has come through during the week with the different sorts of people that we support, that we've been looking at. So the asylum seeking population is a problem. It's the people that are the problem. That's the message of society. It's the homeless people that are the problem. It's the children or their parents that are the problem. And so it went on during the week. So the society has developed this blame culture around people being responsible for their own problems. But of course, the second theme of the week is, from all of us and from all of our presenters, there are solutions to the problem that's caused by systems, that's caused actually by bad policy, and that there are, it could be changed. And hence the second thing, the world could be a beautiful place if we would just work together for change. So I'm just going to go through each of the presentations very, very briefly that we had this week. Just remembering that all of these things have solutions, and every single one of our speakers said so. So we started the week with Virginia from the Jesuit Refugee Service talking about migrants and refugees. And again, you see the language, separation immediately in the language. Those are migrants, they're refugees, they're not us. And somebody made that point actually yesterday about the importance of language. She spoke about our duty to welcome, protect, promote, and integrate. And that has been a very long tradition in Great Britain, which has somehow shifted in the last few years. People don't choose to be a refugee. They don't choose that label. They're people who come because they're in need. The statistics that we got from Virginia were absolutely dire. And she talked a lot about the untrue hype in the UK about the actual numbers. She talked about there being no safe routes, about a purposeful hostile environment. It's horrifying, isn't it, to bring out these sorts of phrases. But she was also clear that there are solutions. There's a better way. There's a better system. And it is possible to achieve. But we've got a, it, there's an uphill battle to fight in attitudes and in policy. One of the things I think for me, again, a common theme, which I'm going to repeat the end of each one is our role is to never give up. Never give up. We must hope in the system being changed, and we must bring hope to the people that we are personally interfacing with that are supposed to be problems, because they're people. Moving on to the second day, we had Alexia from DePaul. And I was remarking at for those of us that have been here all week, the crossover that she talked about between homeless people and people seeking asylum. You know, there's an enormous kind of crossover, which makes it, of course, even more complex. She spoke about young people in particular and the gang culture, the violence that there has emerged, is emerging and has emerged between young people themselves, and the kind of horror of all of that. Where she talked about DePaul, we learned, what struck me was we learned about lots of smaller, new innovative initiatives, which are filling critical gaps. And again, the refusal to give up, to keep on, to bring hope, and to hold hope at the center of so many things. When we moved on to Mari on the third day, she spoke, she was from the campaign No Child Left Behind. And she talked basically about her campaign, which is to do with free school meals. But what struck me there was there were 300 plus groups in support of that campaign, DC Services being one of them. It was a real example, the way she spoke about it, of solidarity, of partnership for impact. And they've had some successes, which she shared with us. A simple objective, one objective for one campaign, which that kind of struck me. The objective, free school meals for every child in the country. Simple, but difficult to achieve. As I say, there have been some successes. There could be a simple solution, and she was full of it. It could be easy, it could be straightforward, but it isn't. Again, they're not going to give up, and there was definite hope in her campaign. Yesterday we had Patrick from Caritas Salford. Again, he spoke about a range of things to do with inclusivity and isolation. But one of the things that he said that stuck with me was we need in our roles to be profoundly empathetic, because the empathy is what compels us to act. If we don't feel what the people are feeling, the action will be hollow or at least less sincere. He said we had to go beyond charity to systemic change. And he was actually the only one that mentioned that phrase during the week. It's a phrase dear to my heart, as many of you know. But fundamentally, everybody this week has talked about systemic change. He said that discomfort and messiness can lead to change. We have to push it. The chaos will overtake and will lead to change. And we've got to be there in the middle of that, because while the chaos is happening, the people need to be cared for. He talked about inclusivity, culture, diversity. And it was yesterday that the major point came out about language and labels, which isolate sectors of society into groupings, and people forget that they're people. And when you listen to news broadcasts, you hear that all the time, that sort of they're not really one of us because they've got this label, or in that they're in that group, and they're a problem to be solved. And again, he brought forward lots of initiatives and ways of being intercultural and inclusive. Again, overlapping with all the other groups of the week, that there are things that separate people. It was clear that they're not going to give up either, and that there is hope. Because I think, and then just this morning, our Mark, there's no doubt about his commitment to systemic change. Or Nathan's either, and the other groups that are involved in social care, which is enormous. So it would be really easy to feel everything is in such a mess and to think there's nothing we can really do. Everything is such a mess, and it is. And every discipline that we looked at this week and the ones that we didn't look at, the UK does seem to be in a mess. I can't speak for Australia, but the sisters there tell me that it's similar. There are a lot of needs that are not being addressed. And that really, it's only government that can make the moves. So much diversity in the week, and yet so much in common. And the overlaps, happened as we went along. I mean, the other thing is, I think it's, with the diversity, is that the aspirations were unified. There was a lot of coming together in aspiration and in how to do things. So I want to just draw some, that was a kind of quick romp through the subjects of the week, just to remind you, but I want to come to some conclusions. The first thing I want to say really is that from my own point of view, I am so thankful for the people who presented this week and for the organizations that they represent and for the attendees of this week who also represent so much vast amount of work. And we're only a small fraction of those who work in all of the sectors that we talked about and in all of the sectors that we didn't talk about. There are enormous numbers of people doing good. And if that isn't a cause for hope, I don't know what is. So I want to express my admiration for all of those who presented this week and for the work that they're doing and everybody else behind their screens. In all of the things I've said already about the asylum, homelessness, child poverty, inclusion, isolation, social care. It's all about the people. And we, with the values that we hold, we know that. It's the individual person is where we come in. But we've also got to help those people to have a voice that they and us together can advocate for change. The old chestnut that I say almost every year seems to get stronger and stronger. We've got to be global in our thought processes. We can't anymore be introspective in the issues that arise in our countries, because they are very now affected and exposed to global issues, global reasons why people are moving in huge droves around the world. And global attitudes towards almost everything impact on us now. Lots of people believed that Brexit was going to sort that out, but most of us knew that it wouldn't, that was a bad sell based on lies. So Global, yes, we've got to have the information. We've got to be aware, and we've had a lot of awareness this week. But in our charism and in our way of being, equally important is the attention we pay to the individual person. And Vincent de Paul, on his feast day, what he was concerned about was the person, the individual, the human being. And he would have often quoted the gospel, you know, where Jesus said, "Where you help me, where you help a person, you're helping me." Because for him, it was the presence of the divine, the sacred in every human being that compels us to be the people who reach out to them. It's complex. What we've seen over the week is complex. As I've said, hardly anything local is not affected by global situations, and that does come down to the individual. And in any of those areas of work that we experience during the week, the individual is there in the situation that they're in. The person that we want to reach has been affected by something global, and often, and more relevantly, something seriously local. The state of the nation seems to be generally dire. Not much reason to be rejoicing in very much. But we have solutions that we can live with. We have a way of being. We have an ability to serve. And we have to get our ability to serve is second to none, I'd have to say. The individual person, the reaching out. But we have to get better at advocacy, and we have to get better at working together across sectors in the areas that we work in, and working together on advocacy. Our voice needs to be joined to hundreds and thousands of other voices, both organizationally and the people themselves. Their voices need to be heard. And the more voices there are, as we've seen in history, the more influence we can have. The problems we saw all have solutions. We must not lose hope in that. And my second point was the world could be a better, beautiful place if we work together. So many agencies, so many wonderful charities, so many rich traditions. Solutions need joined up thinking, and advocacy needs partnership for impact. We all come from a position of moral rightness. Society has a moral duty to treat people properly, rightly, with dignity and respect. That sounds obvious, but I don't see a lot of it in policy. So we have a serious situation to take notice of. We must not be territorial anymore. There are some of us, and there are some organizations in general, quite big ones, who do have to be the front runners. They have to be the big boys. They have to be the ones who achieve. That's not helping us. And I think, again, as Vincentians, our attitude of humility and our attitude of service needs to be leading us away from that and into joining every single voice we can find that is singing from the same hymn sheet. Now, we've been in DC service, we've been trying to do that for a number of years, but we need to do it more. And all of us in our individual charities, you know, we need to get together more. We need to create much more networking, joined up thinking, and all of that. We have learned in DC services this week that if we didn't already know, that our values are distinctive. They are essential. Mark took us through them this morning. They're mandatory for us. They're not a sideline. They're central to what we do. And they're charismatic. But they're not unique. There are many others that would share, and of different faiths as well, that would share in our movement. All of the agencies this week that serve people experiencing poverty express the need for respect, for dignity, for compassion, for kindness. Those words were repeated throughout the week from wherever they came from. And because of the bad systems which cause and create poverty, each speaker talked about choice, change, hearing the voices of the vulnerable, and acting in solidarity for justice. Those of you that know off by heart the DC Services values will know that I've just been through them in a few words. Dignity, respect, compassion, kindness, choice, change, solidarity for justice. So let's join together more. Let's continue learning from each other. Let's network with every like-minded organization we can find. And let's do that deliberately, not just because they fall in our lap or we meet them somewhere. I think Mark's research actually achieved quite a lot in doing that deliberately. Let's tackle the big picture and influence policy. And let's hold that big picture whilst doing what we can for the person we meet and the people around us. There are very, very few who hold those two things in tension. You know, one of the difficulties that I had when I was working with homeless people was that the campaigning organizations had a message that didn't always match my experience with the people I was working with. And also, they didn't come to us for the evidence that they needed for their campaign. So somehow we've got to bring those two things together. And we've got to use our evidence, like Mark told us this morning. You've got to use the evidence that we have. We've got to collect it. We've got to get our people to put that together. Because the thing that speaks most clearly to policymakers is stories of the people we work with. And they're witnessing to that story. You can't avoid that if you're a minister. If somebody's telling you the truth, you just can't. You can't dismiss it. So we've got to get ourselves together between the service delivery and the advocacy. And above all, we need to continue to accompany each other, because we all have needs, to put ourselves in equality with those that we serve, to accompany every person with love, and a love which lightens their load and brightens all those dark places that we have visited this week and brings hope. That's our mission. So I want to invite us all to go from here, refreshed and renewed, to light up the world and to bring hope to all of those dark places that we've been contemplating, and to never give up. So I'm going to play you another video, which I hope expresses some of that, just to conclude our reflection this morning. Oops, get it the right order, Ellen. Okay, we up? Mark?
Yeah, that's up.
In every soul, some brightly burning, some dark and cold, there is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. So carry your candle. The hopeless, light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to.
Okay, sorry about that. You nearly got another one. Okay, so yeah, so go and light your world up. You know, don't lose heart. The mountains to climb are enormous. And I pray today that St. Vincent de Paul will refresh us today and send us off from this wonderful week with fresh hope in our hearts and the determination to just keep going. Don't get the buggers grind you down, as they say. So I thank you for your attention today and for the greatness that you all are and for all those that are behind your screens and all of those that we know have been with us all week and those that haven't, for all that you represent. And as I say, many more who haven't made it to the sessions. I thank you for who you all are, for what you're doing. And I promise you, as I move along in my life, prayers and support as you continue. God bless you all and a very, very happy feast.
Okay. Thank you so much, Sister Ellen. It's a fantastic close to the week and we really appreciate it. And I'm sure many of you will know, for those who don't, Sister Ellen will be leaving the role of provincial soon. Thankfully staying with us with DC Services, but we're just, again, for your support throughout, not just this week actually, but for since Vincentian Values Week was launched. It's been wonderful to have the full-hearted support of yourself and the entire community. So thank you, and thank you for today as well.
Thank you. It's been a good week, Mark. Well done.
Just a reminder, we will make sure these recordings are available online, hopefully by the end of today, if we can. is the aim, certainly by early next week. So if there's anybody you work with or anybody you know who wasn't able to make the sessions, just direct them to our website. They'll be there on the homepage and they can see everything there. So please do pass the links along. And thank you. Thanks for joining us. Happy feast.
Happy feast, everyone. Bye bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye.
Happy feast.
Happy feast.